last topic, I'll try to wind it up as much as possible. I'm indeed happy and also humbled to be among all, I think most of them are all senior physicians here. It was also nice listening to many of the senior professors and senior physicians here. And before going into the topic, Harinath sir was talking about clinical medicine and medicine which is being based more on investigation. But I think still we do give importance to clinical medicine, sir. And being rheumatologists, many times we give more importance to the clinical pattern and the symptoms rather than to many of our costly non-clinical investigations like ANA and rheumatoid factor, particularly in a cost where in a country like India where many patients can't afford many of the investigations. Definitely we need investigations, but without a basic clinical judgment, if you are going to just blindly ask for investigations, it's going to be a waste of money. So without wasting much of time, actually the topic which was given was, it's about the newer management strategies in spondyloarthritis. So what I thought is, instead of going too much into the molecular details, I'll start with back pain, touch upon spondyloarthritis and wind it up with the what are new in the management of spondyloarthritis. So all of us would have got back pain once in our lifetime. I think most of us must have had. If somebody didn't, I think they are really lucky. So most important thing is 90% of us will recover by 1 or 2 months. So we really need not do much except for a symptomatic management or maybe a little bit of physiotherapy. And another most important thing is, many times the pathoanatomic diagnosis means where it comes from, whether it's from the spine, whether it's from the disc or whether it's from the nerve root, it's very difficult to make out. But of course there are significant proportion where it can recur. Particularly if the chance of the initial episode if it's going to persist more than 3 months, then the chance of recurrence is also more. Why this is important is, many times we see a lot of patients would have seen multiple doctors carrying a bunch of MRI. But main thing is, are these MRI really necessary? Shouldn't be talking to the patient about these things, because most of the times it's not a sinister cause, it's going to be something very normal. So causes, being a rheumatologist, I am going to touch on the inflammatory part, the other, but this is not a common one. The most common is the mechanical part, as all of us know. It might be a lumbar spondylosis or disc herniation or spondylolisthesis. So, but now today we'll be seeing on the inflammatory part. Before going into the spondyloarthritis, these are the things definitely we have to watch out for, what we call a red flag sign. Any history suggestive of a spinal fracture or infection or malignancy or any neurological deficits. So any pain which is present during the daytime in an erect posture and it gets relieved during the night time, it's usually a mechanical pain. Any pain which is present at the rest or during the night or when we get up in the morning, it's more of inflammatory. This is the basic difference which you know. So anybody come walks into the clinic, first thing we have to differentiate is whether it's inflammatory or mechanical pain. So any pain which comes after rest or getting out in the morning after a period of 6 to 8 hours sleep, it's more of inflammatory. And usually pain due to any of the sinister causes like an infection or cancer, it's going to disturb our sleep. That is another simple clue. If the pain is going to disturb the sleep, then it's mostly due to any of these causes. So that again has to be elicited. Once we elicit what could be the possible cause, this I just included, there are something called yellow flag signs, because these are the patients who will be mostly consuming your clinical time in your busy diagnosis. Of course they do suffer, only thing you have to sit and talk to the patient. Many a times these patients may not really have a problem in the spine, it might be something else. If it is a female, the pain, cause of pain must be just sitting next to the means, I mean the husband. So what we can do is, you have to just sit with the patient, talk to them what really bothers them, and rather than asking for unnecessary list of investigations or scans. So these are the group which you have to really take care. They are not having any problem, but as I told, the ones who are going to multiple doctors with lot of scans but still they won't be happy. Just tell them daily go for some walking or something and do some core strengthening exercise, that will take care of all the pain. So this is something which you have to remember about the yellow flag signs. So coming to the topic proper, before we used to use a term called ankylosing spondylitis. Now since 2010, they have coined a term called spondyloarthritis. As I know, spondylo means we know spine and arthritis is inflammation. So what are diseases comes under that is, one is ankylosing spondylitis, psoriatic arthritis, patients with skin lesions usually develop this, but patients even without skin lesions also can have psoriatic arthritis, so only there the clinical pattern recognition becomes important. Then reactive arthritis, usually an episode of UTI or a diarrhea causes, and IBD associated arthropathy, diseases like a Crohn's or ulcerative colitis can cause. There are some which doesn't satisfy or fits into any of the criteria, we call it undifferentiated spondyloarthritis. So this is what I told, any patient who walks into our clinic, ask the histories, like if particularly if the patient is a young male, of course females, before we thought ankylosing spondylitis are more common in males. Now the, from 9:1 the ratio has come down to 3:1. Means females are almost as equal affected as males. And the duration of back pain should be for at least more than 6 weeks or 3 months. Usually they have morning stiffness and improvement with exercise and not with rest. This is the most important thing. And yeah, usually a one shot of NSAID, around 70-80% of the pain will disappear. Even that can be a, we can give a therapeutic trial and we can just find out what is the cause of inflammatory back pain. So what happened, why this spondyloarthritis came? We all know that MRI has been a very good investigative tool. So once we got the MRI, initially when we used to do an X-ray, usually after a period of 2 years after the onset of symptoms, we see there is something called SA joint sclerosis or erosions. But with the advent of MRI, we started picking it up bit early. So in MRI, we can see something called bone marrow edema. I have some pictures which I will be showing. So once we picked up this concept called spondyloarthritis came. So this we call it as a pre-radiographic stage or a non-radiographic stage. Even before the thing appears in the MRI, we can pick it up. So initially it is as the pre-radiographic or non-radiographic stage, then it progresses to the radiographic or the traditional term which we used with what we call as the ankylosing spondylitis. But what we should remember is not all the patients in the pre-radiographic stage progress to the radiographic stage. Some of them might hurt or some of them might progress, but we don't know who are really going to progress. Usually patients with high inflammation, severe pain, higher ESR and CRP, the inflammatory markers, they are the ones who will be progressing later to the radiographic stage. So that shouldn't happen. That is our main aim of picking up and treating the patients at this earlier stage. So I'm not going into the details. So spondyloarthritis, whenever a patient comes, we ask for two types of symptoms. One is with regards to only the back, that is called axial symptoms, or patient can also have what we call peripheral arthritis. Usually the joints of the lower limb like knee and ankles will be affected. For example, in diseases like psoriatic arthritis, even the upper limb can be affected. Always remember, combination of rheumatoid and axial symptoms is a patient with the psoriatic arthritis. So these are the ones criteria for axial spondyloarthritis. So we need a diagnosis of sacroiliitis documented in MRI or X-ray, that is mandatory. Along with this, we need all the other features, any of the two features actually. And before HLA-B27, it's a gene which will be passed on to the next generation. One of the genes, there are so many other genes which can be tested in our day-to-day practice. So we used to think this is only for prognostication. Now this has been even used for diagnosis. So a patient with HLA-B27, which few other features of these can be diagnosed to have a spondyloarthritis. So if MRI has already shown features of sacroiliitis, if patient is not affordable, no need to go for HLA-B27. But in case if it is affordable, we can go, because if HLA-B27 is positive, disease might be a bit severe. The chances of having eye involvement will be a little bit more. So but it's optional, it's not that because HLA-B27 is not there, we can't treat the patient. Then as I told, there is something called peripheral arthritis. Even the spine won't be involved, only the lower limb joint will be involved. And another crucial two things which we see in spondyloarthritis, which is not seen in a rheumatoid arthritis, something called enthesitis. There are lot of points at which ligaments and they get attached to the bone, like Achilles tendon, plantar fascia. So these are the points where they will have inflammation and pain, that is called enthesitis. Similarly, one more thing which is very specific to psoriatic arthritis or reactive arthritis, dactylitis. The whole finger will be swollen, means the tendon, like what you call tenous synovitis, and there will be severe bone marrow edema. It will be like a sausage. Whole finger will be swollen. If you see a patient with dactylitis, it has to be a psoriatic or reactive arthritis unless proved otherwise. Of course, there are rare causes like tuberculosis in our country, but the common cause is going to be a reactive or a psoriatic arthritis. So, investigating. To coming to the investigation, when we see a patient with inflammatory back pain, either axial or a peripheral arthritis, we need a ESR, CRP to see how much inflammation is there. This is the most important thing. Then what we go for is, we go for imaging depending on the joint involved. Definitely we have to see the pelvis or the sacroiliac joint. Initially we go for an X-ray. If the X-ray is normal, then we go for an MRI. But as I told, the other group, the mechanical back pain, there is actually no need to investigate unless there are any red flag signs. That is the most important take home message. So this is the X-ray pelvis. This is the sacroiliac joint. Actually this is, you need not ask for any special view. X-ray pelvis, APV, anteroposterior view is simple. That should be fine. What you have to see is whether there is any sclerosis and whether there is any erosion. Many times in females, you have to be careful because they will have dense sclerosis. There is a condition called osteitis condensus again. Particularly multiparous women, more than 2 pregnancies, they can have that. But along with that, there should be joint space erosions, narrowing or widening. Only then we can call them as sacroiliitis. So this, all of us know the typical bamboo spine appearance, the syndesmophytes. This is something which we don't want our patients to develop. That is the most important thing of picking up early and treating them. So in MRI, there are two types of lesions. In X-ray, what we see is only the chronic inflammatory lesions. That is the damage. We don't see the get to see the activity. So only sclerosis, erosions, or the bony bridges or ankylosis can be seen. Whereas in the MRI, what we can see is the bone marrow edema, which is very important. Of course, along with the other findings like capsulitis, erythrocytes. So this is a SA joint in MRI. So MRI, we all know there are two cuts, T1, T2, and there is something called stir. So in the T2 or the stir, what we see is there are a lot of hyperintensities in the SA joint. So that is, if it is present, it is suggestive of bone marrow edema, and it should be present on at least two cuts. So whenever this is present, then we diagnose the patient as an active sacroiliitis, not chronic sacroiliitis. And in MRI itself, of course, we can make out erosions and sclerosis, but mainly MRI we do is to find out the active inflammation in comparison to a CT or a X-ray. So even in the spine, we can see what we have must have heard, like osteitis, Romanov's lesions, and undergraduate or postgraduate, we have read. So these are nothing but shiny corners. These are the ones which later we see in the X-ray as shiny corners. So inflammation is the take-home message. In MRI, we will be able to see bone marrow edema or active inflammation. And if it is present, the patients are very much candidates to go in for what we call something called biologicals, which I will be discussing upon. CT pelvis doesn't have much role, but if the patient is not affordable, it is better than an X-ray, but inferior to MRI. Again, we can't see the active changes. We can just see the chronic changes like sclerosis and erosions. So better to avoid, because all of us know, like X-ray, CT has a higher content of radiation and it's harmful to the patient. So coming to the treatment of spa, whenever we discuss about spa treatment, first thing I always tell the patient is physiotherapy or exercise. So always drive this point into the patient. So the main treatment is going to be in the patient's hands. So exercise is very, very important in a patient with spa. He has to daily undergo spine stretching exercise. He can go for cycling, swimming, whatever, depending. If he doesn't know, at least a cycling should be fine, or at least a floor exercise called spine stretching exercise. Whether irrespective of he has pain or he doesn't have pain, it is very important. Then only we'll start discussing about the medical management. Again, medical management is very simple. We usually divide it into two. Patients who have a pure axial symptoms or what we call spinal pain. Patients who have peripheral arthritis. Peripheral arthritis, it is like rheumatoid arthritis. We are going to use drugs like sulfasalazine, methotrexate. These are the drugs which will be used in a patient with peripheral arthritis. But if the inflammation is confined to one particular joint like a knee or only ankle, we can give intra-articular steroids. So this is about peripheral arthritis. Then we have what we call the pure spinal or axial symptoms. Here there is only two treatment options. Usually the typical AS patient who comes like this, the main problem is going to be in the spine. So along with physiotherapy, initially we give NSAIDs or painkillers. So those days, before the biological era, we didn't have anything. It used to be NSAIDs. Patients used to be treated with NSAIDs. Of course, no, we know what are the side effects of NSAIDs. But it's always, whenever you give any medicine, it is a ratio between benefit and risk. So NSAIDs is the initial treatment. If the patient is not responding to NSAIDs, and if there is a situation where he has to take continuously the NSAIDs, when we think of biologics. So for axial symptoms, either NSAIDs in the early stage, or if not responding, we go for biologics. So what is the criteria for biologics? Biologics is nothing but the newer injections. Usually most of them are available in injections, particularly for spondyloarthritis. Now for rheumatoid arthritis, they are even being found in the oral forms also. So first we have to make a confirm a diagnosis of spondyloarthritis. Most important thing, inflammatory markers should be pretty high, and an MRI should diagnose sacroiliitis, or if it is a later stage, X-ray diagnosis of sacroiliitis is fine. If the patient fails the NSAID over a period of 4 weeks, initially they kept it 3 months, now they have made it 4 weeks, then we have to go for biologic. There are some disease activity which usually we as a rheumatologist we do. If the disease activity score is more than certain level, then we prescribe them biologics. So main thing is patient have high inflammatory markers. They should have MRI or X-ray documented sacroiliitis, and they should have failed NSAID. Means NSAID didn't help them, or there is a necessity for them to take continuously the NSAID. So basically, what are their biologics? Are nothing but they are the drugs which are produced by recombinant DNA technology. The procedure is very complex. So only whether it's original, biosimilar, all those differences comes into play. So that is called biologic. What it does is it targets some specific molecules. We all read in our immunology there are something called inflammatory molecules, IL-1. IL-6, TNF-alpha, like that, specific molecules are there. So they target specific molecules so that they curtail the inflammation. For example, in spondyloarthritis, initially TNF molecules are found to play a major role. So these biologics used to target only the TNF molecule, and they used to give a good response. So main thing is they are produced by recombinant DNA technology, and they target specific cytokines. So I'm not going in detail. So what are the biologics which are available as of now for spondyloarthritis? These are the groups which have been available, TNF blockers. Initially we started with infliximab, etanercept. You might have heard these names, golimumab, adalimumab. Some are subcutaneous, some are given as an intravenous preparation. Now we have some newer molecules called IL-17 inhibitor. These are the newer molecules. They are one which is available is something called secukinumab. These are some molecules which are available and trials are going on, like IL-1223. Then the other molecules, but still they are not into India. There are few more molecules compared to plain ankylosing spondylitis to psoriatic arthritis. Psoriatic arthritis has a bit more biologics. I am just concentrating on ankylosing spondylitis. So these are the molecules I was referring. So coming to that, as of now, any patient who has inflammatory back pain, we make a diagnosis of sacroiliitis. They are not responding to what we call the conventional NSAIDs. Then we go on for biologics. So biologics, two options. One, we have the TNF blockers. Then we have what we call the newer one, IL-17 blockers. TNF blockers, of course, being in India, the risk of tuberculosis was always a little bit high in a TNF blocker. So only always screen for a hepatitis, latent tuberculosis, then only we give the TNF blocker. In IL-17, that risk is not there. Even if patient has a latent tuberculosis positive, the drug called secukinumab may be given. But always, so there is one positive, there can be another negative. This newer molecule, secukinumab or IL-17, should not be given in patients with IBD-associated arthropathy. Patients with inflammatory bowel disease, it can worsen. Though it doesn't has the risk of having a tuberculosis, can worsen the inflammatory bowel disease. So that is the most important thing with the newer drug. So adverse effects is the one, as a rheumatologist, you always face, not only with biologicals, that is with steroids or methotrexate. What I like to pass on the message is, see, there is no drug or nothing in the life without risk. It's like going in a road and meeting with a road traffic accident. All of us see so many accidents, but still we drive. So similarly, in these patients, the benefits are going to far outweigh the risk. And it's not that all of them on methotrexate or all of them on a biological are going to develop a side effect. Only thing, we have to explain it to the patient. Next thing is, these patients have to be monitored strictly. For example, if they are on a methotrexate leflunomide, every 3 months they have to do a blood test so that we can monitor it. Only people who take drugs without monitoring, they are at more chances of having side effects. Similarly, biologics, ideally biological has been found something like insulin. It's something like insulin. It has to be taken lifelong. But in India, I think biologics are pretty costly. For example, for 3 months, the cost is around 60,000. So what we do is, here we give it on demand. We are not going to give continuously. So since we are going to give on demand, the chances of having side effects are very less. So that is the main thing. Thank you.
Can take one or two questions.
The time is over. I want to know the specificity and sensitivity of bone marrow edema as diagnosed by MR.
Sir,
variation caused by various institutions.
Yes, sir. Sensitivity is almost 97 to 99%, sir. Specificity, there are other causes for bone marrow edema. Bone marrow edema, since sensitivity is more, there is specificity always comes to. So it's